So I have the privilege to announce the next speaker, my colleague Laszlo Dézsi. He's coming the same laboratory and he is going to expand much more on the porcine and other models of CARPA, of these anaphylactic reactions to nanoparticles.
Chairman, dear colleagues, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here. Thank you for the invitation for the organizers. And first of all, some words about CARPA itself, because although you may well know, but some of you may not be so familiar with it. So CARPA is the acronym of complement activation related pseudoallergy, and it's a kind of hypersensitivity reaction, an acute adverse effect of intravenous drug infusion or injection, and the main cause of CARPA is that the immune system recognizes these nanomedicines, these nanoparticles, like which are very similar to viruses, and therefore they are activated, and it gives you the CARPA reaction. And using nanomedicines had great advantages, namely the classic side effects of the, for example, the cytostatic drugs disappeared. However, at the same time, new and unthought side effects appeared, for example, in man, this hand-foot syndrome. So that was when it turned out that there is a phenomenon called CARPA. And the major symptoms of CARPA in men comprises many different reactions, like hemodynamic effects, cardiovascular, cardiopulmonary effects, skin reactions, blood cell changes, and they are very similar in the case of humans and in animals. And János told already about the pig model, the porcine model, which is the most important so far. And we have to emphasize that it's a very sensitive model, and it reflects the behavior, the CARPA behavior of the hypersensitive humans. And of course, there are big differences between humans. And I don't go into detail. You also heard about the mechanism of CARPA, but one of the major effects is, of course, complement activation, and then the release of mediators, like pulmonary mediators and also secondary mediators, vasoactive agents, and so on, and also mast cells, white blood cells, macrophages are activated. So it's a rather complex phenomenon. I don't go into details. The question is, what kind of drugs cause pseudoallergy in men? Here you can see this nice list. It's a very big list, and many of the nanomedicines are causing this reaction with a relatively high frequency between 2 to 40%. And now the regulatory response, of course, if there is such a phenomenon in the human setting, clinical settings, then of course regulators must respond. And in the early years, long ago, both FDA and EMA set recommendations or guidance on specific hypersensitivity reactions. And it was continued with this update on EMA's recommendation. And they say that any model should be considered to evaluate the extent of potential adverse events, for example, in the case of developments of lipid-containing nanomedicines, liposome-containing nanomedicines. So it's another challenge for us. So the question arises, what model to be used? And a couple of years ago, János and colleagues reviewed this question, what animal models to be used to test the CARPA effects of liposomal drugs, and it was determined that pigs as well as rats could be suitable for this job. So based on this preliminary data. Our goals are to utilize, first of all, the well-known porcine carpa model to investigate nanotoxicity of novel nanomedicines. And another goal is to develop new rodent models, rat and mouse models as well. We wanted to compare these models using appropriate test agents like zymozan, which is a direct complement activator, Doxil, the first nanomedicine, Ambisome, and Abelset. And Ambisome is a liposomal amphotericin B. But Abelset is not liposomal, but a lipid-containing nanomedicine, which contains as, amphotericin B as active ingredient. So zymozan is a glucan which can be found in the wall of fungi like yeast. But zymozan, as we know, it activates complement system at multiple points, but not only complement system is activated by zymozan, but also NF-kappa-based signaling in resident macrophages via toll-like receptors are induced, so via TNF-alpha and the release of interleukins. It could cause inflammation, like reactions and other reactions, so it's really a complex case. And Doxil, I don't have to talk about this because you all know it very well. The only thing is, I want to emphasize, of course, the main advantage that it not only can be found in the cancer tissue in a high concentration, but also it stays for a long time in the circulation, thanks to this liposomal coat. So therefore, its effect is based on that. And Ambisome is a little bit different. It's a double phospholipid bilayer liposome, and the active ingredient is not inside, not in a solution, but it's incorporated into the wall of this liposome. And Abelset, you saw it also on the list. Here, amphotericin B is coupled to two long chain of phospholipids. And here is the CARPA model. I will skip most of this because János already showed you. This is the flowchart. I just want to emphasize one thing, that the most important parameter in CARPA is the measurement of pulmonary arterial pressure, because this is the most sensitive parameter of CARPA. So here you can see the reaction. Here you can see we listed all the reactions you can be seen in this model. And here is an original recording. And here the topmost curve shows an immediate and huge increase in the pulmonary arterial pressure in response to a nanomedicine injection. And here you can see other parameters, for example, changes in leukocytes, the leukocytosis, and also leukopenia first, and then changes also in the thrombocytes, thrombocytopenia, and also as a marker, we measure thromboxane levels, and thromboxane release follows very well the changes in the pulmonary arterial pressures, and also you can see here the skin reaction in the pig. And János also told you about the tolerance phenomenon, so I'm just showing some examples, so I will skip this. We also did another study where we not only injected Doxil with repeated and increased doses, but also gave infusion of the human equivalent dose, and you can see that this tachyphylaxis persists. But if you investigate Ambisome, it behaves differently. In the case of Ambisome, when you inject it repeatedly, it doesn't cause tachyphylaxis. We don't really know the cause of this difference, or at least I don't know, maybe János knows. But after that, Ambisome works the same. So after this Ambisome, still there is a Doxil response and also the zymozan response unchained. And here are some good news. We not only test liposomes, but also a test in our models, iron-containing compound. And recently, in collaboration with the Nanowataro Consortium and with the Berlin colleagues, we found that one iron-containing nanomedicine, a dextran-coated spion, behaved very well because it doesn't cause any CARPA. On the other hand, other iron-containing molecules are known that they are very carpagenic. And here you can see also the thromboxane changes, but at the end, there was not much, even for high doses of this spion, not much increase in thromboxane B2, but zymosan induced thromboxane. And now, briefly, our rat and mouse models. I skip much of the methodology because I'm running out of time. This is just to show that not only very new equipment could give you good results. This is what we have used. And here it was presented, the first data on the rat model here in Klinam. We originally started with very low doses. I didn't say, but János emphasized that in pigs, pig is a very sensitive model, so very low doses of nanomedicines induce CARPA. For example, 0.01 milligram per kilogram induces already CARPA. So we started around 1, 2.5 in rats, but we didn't really get much reaction. So therefore, we increased the concentration or the dose, and we studied the effects of zymosan at 10 milligram per kilogram, and here you can see we measure mostly not the pulmonary arterial pressure, but the systemic arterial pressure. I didn't emphasize, but in pigs, when you apply a relatively high dose, 0.1 or 0.5 milligram per kilogram, then you also can see not only the elevation in the pulmonary arterial pressure, but a decline in the systemic arterial pressure. So in rats, this is the main parameter. This decrease, this transient decrease, and then a recovery of the systemic arterial pressure by heart rate doesn't change much. And we also see the leukopenia and also the thrombocytopenia. We measured complement activation by a hemolytic activity method with stimulated red blood, sheep red blood cells, and in this method, you take serum samples, and when you induce CARPA, then the CARPA activation means that the complement is consumed in your sample, so you see upon complement activation a decrease in the CARPA levels. So here what you can see, and here is the elevation in the thromboxane. And I just keep these figures because they show the same for ambisome, but I have to say that we need to increase the ambisome dose to 22 milligram phospholipid. So it's also much higher than in the case of pigs. But basically, we saw the same. And here is an interesting figure. János told you before about the PIM cells, the role of PIM cells in this pulmonary arterial pressure elevation. And you can find PIM cells in large number in the pig, but not in the rat. Yet we could see when we measured a right ventricular pressure, and the maximum of right ventricular pressure is pretty close to pulmonary arterial pressure, a transient increase in right ventricular pressure, although there are no PIM cells. So it's a question why does it occur. And just a few words about our CARPA model, mouse CARPA model. First, what we saw, just an opposite response. We published it briefly, and we didn't see the complement consumption, but we saw the opposite. But again, we started with a very low dose of the agent. So then we elevated the dose, and then we saw that in these mice, when you use 100 milligram per kilogram, a huge elevation in systemic arterial pressure. Here you can see similar changes than in the rat. And we repeated the same thing in Abelset, and there's just one very specific thing in Abelset, that upon this elevation and then the following decline, so in contrast to Zymozan, which showed you an elevation and then a decline in the systemic arterial pressure, to Abelset, we saw only an increase and no decline. But you can see a poster outside by Dr. Urfi with detailed data. So in comparison of this model, we can say that the porcine model's advantage is that a most sensitive model, which models very well the most sensitive humans. But there is some drawback that cost and labor demanding, and therefore it's not really suitable for a screening of a number of molecules. While rodent models are not so sensitive, much less sensitive, I would say, sometimes 100 times, 1,000 times less sensitive, but you can increase the dose, and then you can get the same phenomena, and it might be applied to screening. So here is the same that we use further our porcine model for the testing of drugs, but also we think that our model, our rodent models, could be used to test newly developed nanomedicine as well as to study the mechanism of action of CARPA. Here are my colleagues contributed in these studies, and thank you for your attention.
Please wait until I bring you the microphone. The session is being recorded. Thank you.
I would like to propose an explanation for the fact that you didn't see any tachyphylaxis with AmBisome when studying AmBisome. If what you have there is generated by antiphospholipid antibodies, and it is very much more difficult to reach saturation or depletion of those antibodies than anti-PEG antibodies, then maybe that could explain that. Would you agree?
Yes, I think it could be an explanation. So pegylation makes a big difference, as János explained.
I think that I would like to offer, you know, additional explanation. The difference is that Doxil contains cytotoxic drug. And what cytotoxic drug is doing, it would eliminate, in addition to the tumor cells, proliferating immune cells. And you need expansion of the B cells to make the antibodies.
I think one critical experiment is missing from my perspective on the AmBisome. I mean, the Doxy story, actually, we talked so much about, let's leave it. But I think the point about the AmBisome is very interesting. And, you know, in case of Doxil, we did Oxibo. In case of AmBisome, we did not do AmBisome placebo, which is plain liposome of DMPC, DMPG. And the same things is with the stuff of the of the other type of the antifungal that you are using, the
Abelset,
the same thing. It also have PG and PC, so they are very similar, and I'm probably they will cross react anyway, but it's also important to do. And I think to get the picture complete, you need to inject the DMPC, DMPG, either small with cholesterol, small liposome like AmBisome, or the larger whatever particles that use in the Abelset. Let's see the response, so we'll be much more clever, I think.
Thank you very much. I agree with this. Just would like to add that we have done a lot of in vitro experiments with AmBisome compared to Doxil, and we find the two preparations absolutely different. AmBisome has no PEG, but it is highly negatively charged because of the huge amount of PG in it. And the activation proceeds mainly in the alternative pathway, and there is no antibody depletion as a major contribution to the reaction in the case.
I'm not saying anything about the antibody. Someone else said, I don't think.
Yeah, in then Alberto, AmBisome, the lack of tachyphylaxis in the case of AmBisome is the can be explained by the relative minor contribution of antibody antibodies to the endosome reaction. It's mainly alternative activation.
But I mean, all the maybe it's nice, but I want to see proof. Maybe it doesn't help anyone, you know? Maybe.
Well, we were trying to reproduce endosome without amphotericin B, and it's very difficult. The liposome is different. Amphotericin B is necessary as a structural element to reproduce.
No, but did you get effect or not?
We couldn't get liposomes.
What do you mean? You don't know my phone? You don't know my phone? What do you mean you cannot get
liposomes? We go back to the data.
In fact, we couldn't make ambisome with amphotericin B, but we were successful to make up ambisombo, the empty liposome, and we even gave it to rats. We even published this in the Journal of Control release 2 years ago, and it gave a reaction, but a much smaller reaction than complete ambisome. So it doesn't really answer the questions. It's further investigations done, but only in rat, not in pig. We have done this, which is much less sensitive.
Then I would give the floor to Marina.